Next one is the corporate governance. Now, the corporate governance is based on the idea of shareholders' right protection. We know that in a multinational corporation or even in a domestic corporations, the owners are the shareholders, the general public. So if the corporation fails, the ultimate losers would be the general public. So to safeguard the interest of the general public, the idea of corporate governance has been introduced after experiencing the failure in the modern corporate governance practices. So here it says that the single overriding objective of corporate governance is the optimization over time of the return to the shareholders. And to what exactly the corporate governance idea is, it is explained by the Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development in these points. The most widely acceptable statement of good corporate governance practices are as follows. First one is the shareholder right protection is the ultimate goal of corporate governance. Whether these shareholders are minority shareholders or foreign shareholders, their right should be protected. Their right to receive dividend, their right to receive information, their right to receive their right to participate in the managerial affairs of the corporation, and so on. Second one is the equitable treatment of all shareholders. If they are minority, even then they should have a right to defend themselves against the policies which they feel is against the minority shareholders' rights. So they should be able to defend their position in the corporation. Next one is the involvement of all stakeholders in the corporate governance practices. Next one is the disclosure of transparency, that this whole process of corporate governance should be transparent and very clear and should be disclosed at every step to the all stakeholders. And this idea of corporate governance lays the whole responsibility on the board of directors. And it says that the board of directors should be monitored and held accountable for what guidance it gives. So it should be the responsibility of board of directors to ensure the transparency and disclosure of this whole process. The idea of corporate governance was introduced by the two congressmen, Serbens and Oxley. And you might be interested in looking at the pictures of Serbens and Oxley. Here it is. The Serbens and the Oxley. These two congressmen introduced this idea, and the US Congress passed this Serbens-Oxley Act in 2002. And it has four major requirements. The first one is that the chief executive officers of publicly traded companies must guarantee for the authenticity of published financial statement. Next is the corporate board must have audit committee, and which is drawn from the independent directors. Third one is the companies should not make loans to the corporate directors. And fourth one is the companies must test their internal financial control against any possible frauds. If you focus in on all these four points, they are basically designed to protect the shareholders' right. And in case the corporation has failed to achieve these four objectives, there are certain penalties which have been designed for various level of failures. So this is the corporate governance structure of a corporation. There are certain regimes working in the world, for example, where the markets are developed and efficient, like in United States, UK, Canada, and Australia, and the ownership is well dispersed. So the corporate governance regime is the market-based. Market decides. So next one is the family-based. Normally in emerging economies like Pakistan, like India, and Hong Kong, Indonesia, where the majority shares are held by the family. And the third regime of corporate governance is bank-based, like in Korea and in Germany. And fourth one is the government-affiliated, like the China and the Russia. So let's move forward to some currency terminology. The first one is the foreign currency exchange rate. Very simply, it is the price of one currency in terms of units of any other currency, and this exchange rate can be fixed, it can be floating. Second one is the spot exchange rate, the quoted price for a foreign exchange to be delivered at once or in 2 days for interbank transaction. This means that if you go to a money changer for exchanging dollars for pound, the rate at which the dollar would be exchanged for pound immediately would be known as the spot exchange rate. But if you are intended to make a transaction after 4 days or after a week or a month, but you want to finalize the rate today, that this today's rate for the future transaction would be known as the forward rate. Forward rate is the quoted price for foreign exchange to be delivered at specified date in the future. What is forward premium? Very simply, if the forward rate is higher than the spot rate, the difference would be the forward premium, and otherwise it would be a discount, forward discount. What is the devaluation of currency? Normally, where the exchange rate is fixed or pegged to some other currency, if the government decides to change the value of its currency, and if after the decision of the government the currency value goes down, this would be known as the devaluation of currency. So devaluation of currency is a concept related with the actions of the government, and in a regime where currency exchange rates are fixed. Next one is the depreciation of currency. So in a floating exchange rate regime, if the exchange rate changes as a result of the market forces, and if the value of the currency goes down, then this would be known as the depreciation of the currency. So what is the major difference between the devaluation of currency and depreciation of currency? The devaluation of the currency is announced by, or the action is taken by, the government. But for a depreciation of the currency, it is the result of the market forces. The devaluation of currency is a concept related with the fixed exchange rate regime, while the depreciation of the currency is the concept related with the floating exchange regime. The soft or a weak currency is a currency which is expected to be depreciated or devalued in the near future. On the other side, the hard or a strong currency is a currency which is expected to be appreciated or revalued in the near future. And finally is the euro currencies. These are the domestic currencies of one country on deposit in the bank of a second country. The euro currency should not be confused with the traditional European currency, euro. It is a different concept. Every currency which is deposited in a foreign country would be known as the euro currency. For example, if the US dollars are deposited outside US, those dollars would be known as the euro dollars. And if the rupee are deposited outside Pakistan or India, they would be known as the euro rupee. So this is the concept of euro currency. It is the domestic currency of one country deposited in the bank of a second country. And that's the end of review of lecture 1. Thank you for your time.